following program utilizes advanced biomedical equipment and techniques. Because of possible danger or discomfort to humans, a few scenes required use of laboratory animals, primarily for microphotography of blood flow and cell functions. However, all such scenes are accurate representations of actual processes within the human body.
Of all the exotic places on our planet, none is more wondrous, more awesome, than a vast and beautiful world that until recently lay dark and unseen. Just as a child haltingly explores the world about, we have begun to explore the mysterious landscape within. Join us on a fantastic voyage of discovery, an exploration of self, as we look anew at the incredible machine that is the human body. Shakespeare could never have imagined, we shall look at what Hamlet called the beauty of the world, the paragon of animals. From cave wall to billboard, the uniquely human creation called art has celebrated nature's unique creation, the human body. Walt Whitman expressed his exaltation in words, "One's self, I sing, a simple, separate person. Of physiology, from top to toe, I sing. The female, equally with the male, I sing." Set aside now the poet's passion in favor of the scientist's cold analysis. About two-thirds water, plus carbon, calcium, and a few other chemicals, all worth about $5 at the inflated prices of the mid-70s. In one sense, that's all we are, all of us. But right now, your body is performing amazing feats of engineering, chemistry, and physics that no machine designed by man can duplicate. A close look reveals our evolutionary heritage. Male and female alike, our bodies hold as many hair follicles as our cousins, the chimpanzees. Packed with nerve endings, our lips are among the most sensitive parts of the body. Look closely at lips and tongue and marvel at their versatility. Look closer still at the tip of the tongue, magnified 60 times, and marvel merely at the sight. Beauty, we say, is in the eye of the beholder. But all we ever see of one another, skin surface and hair, is dead. Our skin is constantly growing from within, creating new cells that push their way outward, then die near the surface. The whole process takes about a month. Weighing about 6 pounds, the skin is the largest single organ of the body, yet it's only about a 20th of an inch thick. The ridges of our hands evolve to help us hold on to things. Our fingertips hold 2,000 pores per square inch. This giant cavern is merely a single pore, magnified 2,400 times. The green spheres are bacteria, always present, no matter how often and vigorously we may wash. Some 2 million such caverns cover the body, part of our efficient cooling system. Heavy exercise can raise internal temperature up to 7 degrees above normal. The body dissipates this excess heat through perspiration evaporating on the skin. Only a quarter of the energy we produce by muscular exertion is converted into work. The remaining 3/4 is heat. We usually associate perspiration only with heavy exercise or extreme heat. But even under normal conditions, we perspire constantly, between 1 and 2 pints a day. These bizarre scenes show variations in temperature from one part of the body to another. They're made not by visible light, but by heat, on a machine so sensitive it can record heat left behind by a handprint or a moving finger on a wall. Used medically as an aid to detect tumors and diagnose severity of burns, the thermal vision camera converts invisible heat radiation into color video signals. Each color represents a difference of 1 degree Fahrenheit. Blue generally represents lowest temperatures. Red or white, the warmest. Does the skin help cool and protect the body, it also serves as a sense organ. It seems likely that before birth, the fetus receives most sensations through the skin. From the moment of birth, humans seem to require touching and physical affection as much as food.
Oh, what a pretty baby.
As the infant grows older, it will rely more and more on other senses. We are basically visual creatures, receiving about 90% of all our information through our eyes. We're constantly blinking, once every 2 to 10 seconds, bathing and lubricating our eyes with tears. And someone has calculated that blinking causes our eyes to be closed for 1/2 hour out of each waking day. Our iris can adjust to changes in light intensity up to 1,000-fold. The lens of the eye inverts images projected onto the retina. Exactly how we perceive everything right side up is still not fully understood. The Lubricant tears also contain an antiseptic agent that helps defend against disease. Many animals produce tears, but as far as we know, only humans weep as a result of emotional distress. The range of human hearing is exceeded in nature by all kinds of creatures. But our hearing sensitivity is remarkable. A good ear can discriminate some 1,600 different frequencies. Inside the ear, sound vibrates the eardrum, shown here slowed down 200 times. Three tiny bones move vibrations along for conversion to electrical impulses and reception by the brain. The tympanic muscle protects the delicate apparatus against excessive noise. Watching the muscle move, we can see the ear hear.
This is her sister. Oh, I see. Oh, just a minute.
Karen.
Karen, do you know a boy named Walter? Walter. Last name is Brent. Brent, do you remember?
Throughout history, individuals forced to cope with the loss of specific bodily functions have inspired us all with their courage, stamina, and skill.
Okay, just a second. Let me see if she can.
Attempts to repair or replace faulty parts dominate medical research. Almost every day brings new advances in electronics, engineering, and exotic synthetic materials. Through microsurgery and other radical techniques, doctors seek ways to help overcome loss of sight and hearing. This California college student was born deaf. Now she has just had an electronic implantation in her inner ear. A bold new surgical procedure thus far tried on only a handful of patients.
It's very faint, she said.
For the first time, she hears the sound of her own voice. The implant does not provide normal hearing, but in most cases has brought at least a perception of sound where none existed before.
The music.
The enormous range of human sounds is the product of an exquisitely complex system. The meaning of speech, the aesthetic of song, can be altered by minute movements involving diaphragm, lungs, windpipe, mouth, nose, tongue, lips, teeth. The actual sound created by the vocal cords alone is simple and faint. This, slowed down 200 times, is what happens to our vocal cords when we cough, releasing trapped air with explosive force. These wild undulations are but a single cough. In an intricate, life-giving exchange, we take in about a pint of air with each relaxed breath, around 14 every minute. Inside, we work somewhat like a bellows. The diaphragm pulls down, chest wall expands, and air rushes in to fill the partial vacuum. The trachea, or windpipe, splits into two large tubes, the bronchi, one going into each lung. Smaller bronchi branch off into ever smaller passages, much like branches and twigs growing off from a tree trunk. Entire gracefully swaying structure is often referred to as the bronchial tree. The tiniest twigs of the tree terminate in the alveoli, 300 million microscopic air sacs, which constitute the bulk of lung tissue. Entwined with clusters of alveoli, a network of capillaries, microscopic blood vessels. Air sac and blood vessel lie side by side. Through incredibly thin, transparent membranes, red blood cells snatch up oxygen and surrender waste, carbon dioxide, to be exhaled. Responding to stress, the intertwined systems, respiration and circulation, display remarkable adaptability. Lungs and heart can perform prodigiously, pumping about 10 times the amount of air and blood we need when we're relaxed. The heart's double-barreled pumping action propels blood through the system under great pressure. This is how it sounds, recorded with a tiny microphone inside a living body. Blood, the river of life, journeys endlessly through 60,000 miles of blood vessels. Thank you. Blood's main function is carried out on the cellular level. Oxygen, water, and nutrients are delivered to every body cell, and waste products are collected. A complete tour out from the heart and back takes less than a minute, from vessels 1 inch in diameter to capillaries and venules so small that blood cells must line up to squeeze through one at a time. Even during the most commonplace of our daily routines, our bodies are the scenes of dramatic action. Facing the threat of invasion by hostile bacteria or other foreign organisms, the body mobilizes for defense. Among its donut-shaped red cells, the bloodstream contains a small, highly mobile strike force, leukocytes. White cells. Wriggling about under its own power, a leukocyte seeks out, attacks, and consumes a foreign invader. White blood cells are both warriors and scavengers. In addition to their battlefield duties, they help cleanse the bloodstream of debris. Thick and tough muscle, the heart is a marvel of mechanical performance. Beating 70 times a minute, it pumps 2,000 gallons a day. One-way valves prevent blood flow from backing up. Merely the size of a fist and weighing less than a pound, the body's dynamo pumps 55 million gallons in a lifetime. Regarded as the temple of the soul or the seat of intelligence, the heart and its corridors nonetheless inspire awe and reverence for the beauty and efficiency of nature's design. To utilize raw materials that build tissue and supply energy, the human body employs a complex chemical conversion process. Despite frequent abuse, our digestive system routinely performs extraordinary feats of chemistry. Even before the first bite, the mouth prepares by increasing secretion of saliva. Mostly water, saliva helps chewing and swallowing and contains enzymes that begin the digestive process. Down the gullet or esophagus, a tube 9 to 10 inches long, less than an inch wide, leading to the stomach. Like most of the digestive tract, the esophagus is lined with muscles that squeeze and relax, pushing food along every step of the way. War cells of the stomach churn the food and mix it with enzymes and acid. In normal digestion, the stomach produces hydrochloric acid strong enough to burn a hole in a rug, but protects itself with a glistening layer of mucus. In the overall digestive process, the stomach serves largely as a way station. Most of the work takes place in the small intestine. Millions of tiny villi lining the intestine help convert usable nutrients into forms the body can absorb. Total distance traveled between intake and outlet, 30 feet. Total time, 1 day. Despite our wide variety of motion, our muscles can do only one thing, contract. We're painting them red and blue, flexors and extensors, to show their arrangement in opposing pairs. One muscle contracts to pull a bone forward. Its opposite number contracts to pull it back. Forward and back, up and down. The entire range of movement derives from muscles' one-way action. We have in all more than 600 muscles, comprising about 40% of body weight. Our bones, amazingly strong and light, make up only 18% of our weight. Healthy joints are lined with a glassy smooth cartilage and lubricated by a thick fluid said to be so effective that nothing technology has produced can match it. Of the body's 206 bones, more than half are in the hands and feet. Except for a few flightless birds like the ostrich, humans are the only animals that get around exclusively on 2 feet. Compared with four-legged creatures, our walking is complex and acrobatic. As one expert describes it, without split-second timing, man would fall flat on his face. In fact, with each step he takes, he teeters on the edge of catastrophe. So skillfully designed is the structure of our bones and joints that we can absorb great stress. In running, legs and feet take up to 5,000 pounds of pressure per square inch. And in some athletic events, like jumping, pressure is estimated at up to 20,000 pounds. The engineering design of the human body reaches its apex in the hand. Powerful and precise servant of the mind, creator of civilization and culture. Twenty-five joints give it 58 distinctly different motions and make it the most versatile instrument on earth. Thank you. dependent for survival on speed, agility, and strength, it is ironic that we can extend our bodies to achievements our primitive forebears could not possibly imagine. Piece of work is man, wrote Shakespeare. In form, in moving, how express and admirable. In action, how like an angel. The beauty of the world, the paragon of animals. In all important respects, Homo sapiens reproduces its kind in much the same way as most other mammals. But as far as we can determine, we are the only species that consciously connects mating behavior with subsequent offspring. We have begun to understand how sexual reproduction works, and the more we learn, the more wondrous and awe-inspiring it seems. Now, cameras have recorded the complete process of how life in most mammals begins. In her ovaries, a woman has nearly 500,000 egg cells, but only 400 or so will ever get the opportunity to create a new life. One by one, over much of her lifetime, they will develop into mature eggs, covered by a protective jelly and surrounded by fluid. Inside the ovary, nourished and secure, the egg grows until the ovarian wall swells and, like a volcano, erupts. Surrounded by its protective jelly, the mature ovum, perhaps the largest cell in the human body, is ejected from the ovary. It's called ovulation, and it happens more or less on schedule every 28 days. If not fertilized, within 1 to 3 days, it will die, to be flushed out of the system with the next menstrual flow. The fringed opening of the fallopian tube awaits the approaching egg. Muscular contractions and microscopic lashes set up an undulating motion that will paddle the potential source of life to its destiny. The male's contribution, sperm, are among the smallest cells in the body, but their numbers are astronomical. During manufacture, incipient sperm cells reduce by half the normal human complement of 46 chromosomes in each cell, preparing to combine with the 23 chromosomes of the egg. Where the female matures one egg a month, the male produces some 200 million sperm a day. For couples planning to start or increase a family, timing is critical. Only during a few days around the middle of a woman's menstrual cycle is her egg capable of being fertilized. Ejaculated into the female, a vast armada of sperm, 200 to 500 million strong, swims energetically about half an inch a minute toward the fallopian tube. Forced to struggle against muscular contractions propelling the ovum toward them, only the strongest will reach their goal. Now the reason for the sperm's prodigious numbers becomes evident. By the millions, they beat against the jelly protecting the egg. Their chemical makeup helps dissolve the coating. Once a single sperm has penetrated the ovum, a chemical change will take place to prevent all others from entering. Ovum and sperm begin to unite, and the union, now called a zygote, will successively divide into many cells. There is so much we don't know, but logic tells us that at this moment, the zygote contains specific information for one Homo sapiens of given sex and color and potential size. Perhaps even intelligence, personality, health. The contributions of 10,000 generations. A blueprint for a creature of 60 trillion cells in a package no bigger than the point of a pin. Pushing and squeezing, the tissues of the fallopian tube propel the fertilized ovum toward the uterus or womb. The journey will take 5 days to a week. As growth continues, the zygote violently expands and contracts, in appearance much like an exploding star. A rich supply of blood flows to the waiting uterus. A portion of the uterine wall will unite with the outer layer of the ovum to form the placenta, which will nourish the new life. Now called a blastocyst, the ovum slowly enters the womb, its universe, for the next 260 days. About a week has passed since conception. There are no sensations, no clues to tell the woman that she carries the beginnings of a new life. The blastocyst has embedded itself in the uterine wall. It is, in the second week, a disc made up of hundreds of cells getting ready to begin the task of creating individual organs. In the third week, the fundamentals of the human body now begin to take shape, and the camera is privileged witness to the beginnings of the spine. A primitive heart forms and begins beating. It is the fourth week. Relative growth so great. In the first month, the egg has increased in size 10,000 times. Soon the mother will sense the profound changes in her body. She carries within her an expanding universe. Billions have preceded. Billions will follow. And no two ever will be exactly alike. Science, with its ever more sophisticated tools, probes deeper and deeper into the secrets of nature. Knowledge takes on an aura of fantasy. We learn, for example, that every cell in the body contains the genetic blueprint for making a complete individual. And yet, each type of cell is highly specialized. Even when removed from the heart and placed in a nutrient solution, a single cell of heart muscle continues to beat. In another laboratory experiment, two heart cells in a culture dish beat individually, each at its own pace. But when they touch, they synchronize and beat in unison. We have barely begun to understand the potential of the human brain, control center of the incredible machine, and the most complex of all living organs. How, for example, to account for hypnosis or the seemingly bizarre feats of exotic Eastern disciplines? Recent knowledge indicates that the brain is capable of giving us voluntary control over bodily states to a greater degree than we had ever thought possible. Using sophisticated electronics, researchers like Dr. Barbara Brown have developed techniques called biofeedback, enabling individuals to alter various functions. By listening to a beeper device, activated by heartbeat, for example, a subject can learn to vary the rate at which the heart pumps.
We never thought that we could do this before. We've always been told, medical science has acknowledged, that most of our body runs on automatic. It's automatically regulated. Now, what biofeedback has shown to us is that we can mobilize some higher mental function to supervene, to intervene in an automatically regulated body function, such as blood flow or blood pressure, and bring it under our own voluntary control at will. We can apparently work with almost everything in the muscle system, almost everything that's innervated by what's called the autonomic nervous system, all of the vital functions of the heart and blood pressure and so on. In the future is the control of various brain electrical activities.
Subjects have learned to identify and control different types of electrical waves emanating from the brain. Electrodes picking up brain electrical activity are connected to an electroencephalograph, an EEG machine, which in turn regulates flow of current to a toy train. When the brain emits waves of a specific frequency, alpha waves in the case of this subject, the train moves. The larger the alpha waves emitted, the faster it goes.
The implications are so vast, it's very difficult, I think, to try to describe what they all might be. I think they will be in the area of learning to control various aspects of one's own mind, mental activity, and consciousness as well. Obviously, learning how to control or cope with emotional problems. Certainly, what we know now is that biofeedback procedures can be used to bring a great many disturbing physical illnesses back or under control back to a more proper functioning. I think it's almost limitless.
In the words of Joseph Conrad, the mind of man is capable of anything because everything is in it. All the past, as well as all the future.